Hello and welcome to ETBFSI. This is Shreyasana and I have with me Harshil Mathur, the CEO of Razorpay. Hi Harshil, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So you know Harshil, over the last few years, the payment system has seen a great evolution.
Yeah.
On one hand, we've witnessed UPI gaining a lot of traction. And on the other hand, we've also seen the payment space grappling with the zero MDR challenge. So as an insider, how do you express or what's your view on the evolution that has taken place?
I think this is very exciting times for payments industry overall. There's a lot of government push towards it, a lot of regulatory oversight, and basically a lot of things are changing. Last year we saw the launch of UPI a couple of years back. Last year was the most eventful year for UPI. It crossed $1 billion a month. We have played our own role in enabling that. We had a rise and fall of wallets. We now have a lot of things coming on cards, like tokenization, a lot of new things coming up. UPI 2.0 launched this year. There are a lot more changes expected in UPI. Recurring payments were enabled. So overall, I think the market is shaping up very strongly. We enable merchant payments. So we power more than 6 lakh businesses in India right now for online payments. Companies like Ola, Swiggy, Zomato, GoIBibo, and so many more. And one thing you have noticed is that the merchant side also, the merchants are really excited about digital payments right now. They want to uncover more use cases, they want to uncover new things, and I think innovation is the key driving factor right now. Whoever is the first one to deliver the new changes or the new products that are coming up in the market is the one that's adopted, and that's the reason Razorpay has grown as fast as it's grown last year. Yeah, of course, when things change, business models also evolve. So things like zero MDR, it's not a surprise. It was already expected. There was already a downward pressure towards MDR. And we prepped up for that. So we integrated our services and charged separately for every service that we offer.
You know, you've recently launched the credit card for SMEs and startups.
Yeah.
So how do you intend to scale up your cards business?
Yeah, so the interesting thing about our business is that we work with more than 8 lakh merchants today.
Okay.
In the online space. And in that, we see their transaction history on a daily basis, how much money they receive, how much money they pay out, what kind of cuts do they keep and things like that. That allows us to have a very bird's eye view on a business's flow. So we decided what can we do with that data, and one of the biggest asks in a merchant community is lending. Generally, startups and SMEs don't get lending very easily because they don't have strong balance sheets, they don't have profitability. So standard asset-based lending doesn't work for them. Last 1 year has been especially really bad for the SME credit market and credit market in general. And what our view was, how can we enable flow-based lending? Because that's the kind of lending that can work for these businesses, where we look at their business flows, where we look at their transaction history and allow them to have a flexible, credit limits. So the way our credit card is structured is that we underwrite it and we work with banks to enable an SME or a startup to get credit. And the limits are very, very variable. So it can go as low as 10,000 rupees a month to as high as 25 lakhs a month. And the limits would vary every month based on how you are using it, how your business is doing overall, and based on how much risk we think we can take on you. That allows us to have a very flexible model of credit. So if your business is doing well, you have easier access to credit. If your business is doing worse, you can have lower access to credit. But you don't have to go and apply for a loan every time you need credit. You get a 40-50 credit window. You can use it to fund inventory. You can use it to fund marketing campaigns. You can use it to fund SaaS subscriptions. It could be basically anything. But the idea for us is that how can you make credit more easily and timely accessible? And that's what we are solving in the launch of corporate credit card for SMEs.
Right. That's very interesting. You've also expressed interest in entering the new banking space, but there is right now there is no prominent regulation around that.
Yeah.
So how do you strategize yourself around it?
And so the way we look at neo banking is essentially, we don't look at neo banking as a competition to traditional banking. I think traditional banks do what they do really best, managing compliance, managing money flows, doing the treasury component of money. What we really believe is that the needs of the startup and tech industry in general are very different than what banks are able to provide today. So a combination of a bank and a fintech can really do wonders, because bank does, so in our case, the way we are building neobanking is that we build the tech and product layers on top, while bank manages, actually holds the money, because they are of course regulated by RBI and allowed to do that. And that marriage of a bank and a fintech, it really produces the magic. Mm-hmm. That's what our neobanking is. So Razorpay X is our neobanking platform, which we launched just a couple of weeks back, where we are partnered with a couple of banks. So if you are a business, you reach out to us, we work with you to open your current account with one of those partner banks. And then you interact with our tech and our product rails to manage your bank accounts, everything from dashboard to APIs to payables to receivables to vendor management to payroll. everything happens on the Razorpay platform, but your money is still safely lying in an RBI regulated bank. And that marriage is what neobanking, I believe, in India would be. Because in India, I think there is a significant advantage in trust that banks have been able to build. Mm-hmm. If a tech company like ours can build on top of the trust and allow business to get differentiated products on top of it, that will be really a win-win for the market.
So, you know, in terms of new opportunities, be it in product launch space or partnership, are you exploring anything?
Yeah, we are exploring a lot of things. So this year itself, this was the first year when Razorpay did our first acquisition in the start of the year called Third Watch, which is a Gurgaon-based company which helps control fraud for e-commerce businesses. It uses AI to look at almost 300 parameters to reduce the amount of fraud that happens. Mm-hmm. The second acquisition we did was late this year, which we announced last week, is Offin, which is a payroll management company, which plugs into our new banking platform to allow businesses to manage salaries, payrolls, taxation, TDS filing, all of those things under one single platform. So we are looking strongly at building an entire platform of banking services on top of the Razorpay platform. And we are exploring opportunities where we can work with other companies in partnership board, where we can acquire a small company to scale something new, or in some cases we build those things. But I fundamentally believe that fintech is a domain where partnerships play a key role.
Absolutely.
Not everything can be built by you. And the true value to the ecosystem comes when multiple entities partner together to build something good for the market. Partnerships is a key. Like as a fintech, we believe that we don't want to do everything. We want to stick to what is core to us, and we are a protein tech company. We want to stick to that. Everything else, we'd rather find a partner who does it better.
Right. Do you believe that invisible payments is the future?
Definitely. I think over time, payments are becoming less and less visible. And the best payment experience is where the customer doesn't even know. Where the customer just says, I want to buy this product, figure out how you charge me. And that is the future, where the customer will say, this is a product I like, buy it for me. And you figure out how does authentication happen in the background. You figure out whether it's the right customer, which card or instrument he prefers, and allow the transaction to happen seamlessly. That's the future. That's the experience Amazon already delivers in markets like US. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure those are the kind of experience we'll see in markets like India. We're already seeing like the way UPI works is significantly better than the way card system used to work. You don't have to enter your card number, expiry date, name, CVV, OTP, just a PIN. All of that, everything else has been removed off.
Right.
I think over time, we'll see a future where PIN will also go away. They'll either look at your biometrics, look at your voice, look at other factors to identify whether you are the customer who is supposed to do this transition, and it will all happen seamlessly. That is definitely the future. And there's a lot of innovation happening in that. RBI recently, last year, released the tokenization guidelines. We still have to see companies to adopt to it, but I've heard a lot of companies are working towards enabling tokenization on their platform. Recurring mandates on UPI is the next big thing we all are looking forward to.
But do you believe invisible payments is a safer bet?
I think the way the ecosystem thinks about payments in India is that safety is the first aspect, whether it's regulators, whether it's banks, whether it's even companies like us. The reason for that is simple. India is still a place where digital payments are just getting adopted. Most of the customers are transacting for the first time, and everybody wants to ensure that they have more than convenience. We solve for trust. The biggest reason people still opt for COD or cash payments in most places is because they don't trust digital payments as much. So trust is the first thing you have to solve for. Convenience comes later. For that, it is essential that every new way of authentication or new way of payment that comes in the country solves for the trust factor first and solves for the safety factor first.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't believe anyone would be stupid enough to build a platform or build a form of authentication where the trust or the safety aspect is not solved for. Even with UPI, like the MPIN based system, has actually, while it removes a lot of unnecessary factors, still a significantly more trustworthy and most safe way of payment than your standard card. We've seen globally how many frauds happen on card payments. While UPI has seen its fair share of frauds, it's still significantly lower than what happens on cards. The reason for that is it's built with safety in mind.
So do you think, you know, I mean, we've spoken a lot about how India has achieved paramount success in the digital payment space.
Yeah.
How do you compare India with other mature financial ecosystems?
So if you talk from a product and platforms that we have, India is, I think, significantly superior than Western markets. There's nothing like IMPS in Western markets. You still can't move money instantly to your friends or family. Like if you have to send money, it takes at least 2 to 3 days. Like ACH in US is significantly slower. So IMPS is a world-class platform that we have for bank transfers, NEFT is moving 24/7 this year as well. So that will be another exciting thing to see. Something like UPI doesn't exist across the world, forget just Western markets. UPI is a payments platform, payments rail, which is authentication, everything built on top of a bank account, works for smartphones. It's a payment instrument built for the smartphone generation. And we're seeing all over the world, people are looking up to UPI and trying to replicate it. So the platforms that we have are significantly better than across what is available across the world. The only challenge is our adoption is still significantly lower.
Right.
In US, for example, just looking at payments acquiring as a market, total payment acquiring market in India is like $60 to $70 billion. While in US, one single acquirer does $1 trillion. So scale is significantly different. China at its peaks does 500,000 transactions per second. We do 2,000, 3,000 transactions per second at its peak. So still 100 times smaller than China in terms of scale.
So when do you see the scale bridging up?
The next couple of years will be interesting to watch out for, because our digital payment, digital economy, size of digital economy is still significantly small.
Mm-hmm.
It's about 3 to 4% of the total GDP, and there's a significant headroom available. But the way things are shaping up, the way the market is shifting, I have no reason to doubt that India will reach or even overtake markets like US or be similar to markets like China in the next 3 to 4 years. And that will be interesting to watch also. The size of digital economy should grow multifold from here, 3%, we should at least be 15, 20, 25% for India to be called equivalent to Western markets.
Thank you, Harshil. That was indeed a very, very interesting conversation. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for watching ETBFSI. Please follow and subscribe.